Hello everybody, my name is Karl-Eugen Hoyos, I'm from Vienna, I'm an FFmpeg developer. I'm particularly thankful to be invited here. I always love No Time to Wait, and it's a pleasure for me to talk today. For those who were in Vienna 2 years ago, this is a very similar presentation, but I thought to myself, the audience probably is not 100% identical, so I hope you can live with that. So FFmpeg is a project that was mentioned several times today, but I wondered if everybody knows everything about it, and I can say a few words about it, I think. It was founded around 2000 by a French developer, Fabrice Bellard. He's not active in the project for a very, very long time, but he still owns the trademark and the homepage and the domain. So if we need him, he can be contacted. 15 years ago, another Austrian developer, Michael Niedermeyer, took over management of the project. He is now not the project manager anymore. There is no sole project manager, but Michael is still active, and he's still among the two most active developers. Nowadays, he mostly does security things, meaning that Google and others inform us of possible security problems within FFmpeg, and Michael is the first one to look at them. In the past, he has done things like the H.264 decoder. FFmpeg is, I would say, a large project. It has more than 1 million lines of code and much more than 1,000 contributors and more than 1,000 copyright holders. Per year, there are around 3,000 commits. This number is constant, at least in the last year. Contributors are going slightly down, but this is not our main problem. There's a sufficient number of contributors, but not a sufficient number of reviewers. The license is LGPL, that means the software can be used in proprietary software projects. There are optional parts that are not LGPL. And we only offer source code. There you will not find binaries or products on the FFmpeg homepage. There are independent people who provide binaries for people who don't want to compile themselves. The project offers three main command line utilities: FFmpeg, the transcoding tool, FFplay, a video player that I would consider more of a testing tool, so I would not use it to watch a movie, but it has some advantages like subtitle display that you maybe not find in other players. FFprobe is a program to show some properties of multimedia files. I don't use it myself, but it was already mentioned today, so obviously it has users as well. And there are some tools that are important if you deal with multimedia files, but they are not as important. The project offers 8 libraries. I will talk about libav format and libav codec later. And the other libraries are utilities that are useful, and some of them, like libpostproc, is necessary to do a specification compliant decode of MPEG videos, so they are definitely useful libraries. LibSW scale is a not exactly new library to do color space conversion and scaling algorithms. Some say it's not really up to date and its quality is not good enough anymore. However, it is what we have, and as always, patches may be welcome. LibSW resample does the same in the audio domain, meaning it does resampling and channel layout change, similar things. So libav format is the library that we provide to read multimedia files. FFmpeg supports all the main formats, that some of them exist for very long, some are newer. I believe Ogg was mentioned that would be a format that's, some say fortunately, not as in much in use anymore. But if you look at the MPEG streams, that's how broadcast is still done all over the world, and it's supported by FFmpeg. We have heard about Matroska and WebM already today. And the other are the formerly proprietary formats of the big companies. Nowadays, except for MP4, they are mostly out of date, but that doesn't mean that you don't have such files, so I believe it's quite useful that FFmpeg supports those former standard containers like AVI and ASF. But that's not the only thing. There is some MXF format. It was mentioned that it's not perfect. FFmpeg is not bug-free and not feature-complete, but at least many MXF files can be read, and it's also possible to write such files with FFmpeg. The HLS-dash streaming support is rather new. There's a Chinese developer who spends a lot of time on them, and I have tested many streams, and it works quite well, and it can be used for both reading and writing, which is certainly an additional feature. It might not be so relevant for you, but it's still something that the users of FFmpeg apparently need. And the next three formats are mostly audio formats or streaming formats. One format was implemented within the FFmpeg project, the NAT format. It has the main advantage over all other mentioned formats that it supports raw video very, very well. And this is unfortunately not true for the other containers known to me. I cannot talk about all the formats supported by FFmpeg. This is a mostly complete list. There are some on this list that I wouldn't know exactly what they are about. I would have to look into the source code. But that I show this slide because I believe it might be useful for you to understand that we support many old and many very unusual formats for reading, yeah? And that could be the reason why FFmpeg is a very important tool for all of you. LibAV codec, as said, LibAV format is more about the file formats. There's another library, LibAV codec. You could say that's the main library of FFmpeg. It is used by not only many video players, but also companies like YouTube and Vimeo to decode incoming video. And the LibAV codec supports all the, let's call them old-fashioned codec, like MPEG-1, MPEG-2 video, like H.263 video. And when they were implemented at that time, it was still common to first write an encoder for the format to understand it better, and then later write the decoder. This has completely changed. Nowadays, decoders are considered like the beginner's task, and encoders are the hard thing. There are sadly no more new video encoders within FFmpeg, within LibAV codec. They are external libraries that you can use to encode things like H.264 and HEVC. VC1 is the Microsoft code that used to be the Microsoft codec that was used at the same time as H.264. It's used on Blu-ray, so while it's not in active development for a very long time, it's still very easy to find files that use VC1. This is just a list of other codecs that are mainly, some of them are quite out of business nowadays. Yeah? All the predecessors of VP9, for example. VP4, by the way, is a new codec that didn't exist for which we had no decoder 2 years ago. And you see the intermediate formats that I believe you have all heard about, DNX, HD, ProRes, and Cineform. All three can be decoded with FFmpeg. DNX, HD, and ProRes can be encoded. Sometimes people are not happy with the result of the encoding. As said, bugs happen. At least two video codecs were invented within the project. FFV1 is a lossless codec that you have heard about. Snow is a wavelet codec that at some point was very... what was a very interesting project because it promised nice quality at very, very low bit rates, but it's now, well, yesterday's snow. So I didn't mention AV1. For those who do not know AV1, this is kind of the future video codec, supposed to be used in hardware, and it is already used by YouTube. And this is a royalty-free codec that is said to produce significantly higher quality than HEVC, the, let's say, newest codec for which you have to pay royalties. It is very, very slow at encoding time, but usually you encode only one, so that's not the main issue. At decoding, it is comparable to other codecs. There is no internal decoder yet, but luckily we already have two external decoding libraries and two external encoding libraries, so the choice is all yours, which one to use. Video is not the only thing in multimedia, there's also audio, and FFmpeg supports all the old codecs like MP3 and MP2 that you know from the broadcast world. It supports the Dolby codecs even for encoding. It supports AAC and DTS, including DTS HD Master. That means that you can, if you get a lossless 8-channel decoding, that FFmpeg can use it and transform it into anything you might need. Once upon a time, just as with NUT and SNOW and FFV1, there was an attempt to create an audio codec within LibAV codec. Sadly, it failed. Sonic is not useful, sadly. Image formats were, while they do not play such an important role when doing movie playback, which obviously was one of the important factors when FFmpeg was new, we still try to support all kinds of image formats. Yeah? So there was a BMP and PNG and SGI and TIFF and DPX encoder all the way back. There are two different lossless JPEG formats. Both are supported for reading and writing. So it was always the goal of the developers to fulfill even the most strange needs that you could not easily justify. There is also a JPEG 2000 encoder and decoder within FFmpeg. It is not feature complete, but you can create lossless video with JPEG 2000. So if you, for whatever reason, believe that FFV1 is not the right codec for you, but FFmpeg as a tool is, there is a JPEG 2000 encoder. The filter library is probably the one that sees most development. Paul Mehol, one of our most active contributors, is writing filter and filter and filter. And there are so many that it's really, really difficult, in my opinion, to keep track of what they can do. But at least all the standard things that you need every day, like scaling and cropping and overlay, are present. There are different deinterlacers. The main difference is their speed. And we have several inverse Taylor scene filters. And relatively new is the possibility to do frame rate interpolation. This is extremely time consuming, and I'm not sure if the result is always what one wants, but at least the possibility exists. This slide is unchanged. I just tried to find examples of formats that once upon a time were used by not necessarily PCs, but on game console in this case. All these formats are supported by LibAV format and LibAV codec and can be read by FFmpeg. I believe this is really a very important feature of FFmpeg, that it can read old formats. Yeah? Not all of you might have access to such formats, but I guess archives exist that do have such files. Windows Media Video, I didn't double check, but I have a suspicion that there are some old videos made on Windows platforms with Microsoft software that you cannot play back on a vanilla Windows 10 computer. And in this case, FFmpeg obviously is a very helpful tool. It is written in C using POSIX specifications, so there is a good chance that you will be able to compile FFmpeg with future compilers. I'm not saying that all versions of FFmpeg can be compiled with all known compilers, neither that all past and present compilers can compile FFmpeg, but at least the changes that are necessary may be so small that there's really a good chance that it will be usable in the foreseeable future. Something about us, NIH is a geek's term for not invented here. So normally it is used in a negative context because you don't want to re-implement everything. Yeah? Do not re-implement the wheel, or as the C programmer said once upon a time, you can better read it than I do. We were once asked, why is everything re-implemented within FFmpegs? Why do you re-implement the wheel? And the answer was, our wheels are rounder. This is also an old slide. Software has bugs by definition, yeah? And I'm just mentioning this specific bug because it was there for a very long time. It was very difficult to find the bug, yeah? And it might affect you. Yeah? If you used FFmpeg in the past to encode an audio file in the FLAC format, note that we have a native FLAC encoder, so I'm not talking about the library that people mean when they talk about FLAC, but the FFmpeg native implementation had a bug. So without you knowing, the file that was produced was not lossless if you decoded it with another application. Such things happen, and I believe you should keep that in mind. I tried to find things that were new in the last 2 years. I asked some of my fellow developers. They were the number of suggestions was surprisingly limited. But I looked into the change log and I saw that Paul has implemented 8-channel Dolby Digital Plus decoding, which was a feature that was missing for a long time. As said, he has implemented so many filters that I did not want to count them. I talked already about VC1, definitely a format that is not like a complete fringe format, but on the contrary, a format that was used once upon a time. No other open source codec implementation of VC1 exists. The VC1 decoder within libav codec was known to produce visual artifacts from time to time, and kindly a developer, Jerome Bosboom, has made our decoder bit exact, which in my opinion is a huge step in the right direction. I talked about the streaming improvements, and we have lots of hardware acceleration, meaning you don't have to wait until the library is finally finished with encoding. You can use hardware encoding on all current platforms. There was one thing that was heavily discussed within the project. We removed an external, it should be say library and not filter, sorry. The company that provided the external library and for which we provided the wrapper decided that they are unhappy with us not providing binaries. Why did we not provide binaries? Because the license of the external library was not compatible with the license of FFmpeg. So you could compile FFmpeg yourself and use this proprietary library, but you are not allowed to distribute it. When they started to distribute it, although they knew that this is not what we would like and it's not legal, sadly, we decided to remove the external library. I'm saying this because normally we try not to remove features. In this case, I personally did not see a better solution. And my last slide is just about the regular questions from the archivists to me is, I put a file into FFmpeg, I asked it to create a lossless output file, and then I used FFmpeg to create the original file, but it isn't identical. If you're searching for zip or tar, then FFmpeg is not the answer. It is not a file archiver, not even similar to a file archiver. You can transcode audio and video, and you can make sure that the audio is bit identical, and you can make sure that the video is bit identical. But with file formats, you never get the same format again. Peter was talking about identifiers in Matroska files today. And of course, if you re-encode the Matroska file losslessly, you will not get, the idea is that you do not get the same file identifier. So you do not get the same file. Any questions?
Questions? Yes.
Hi, it's Peter Westinger-Steindl again. I have to do this for the camera.
I know.
paying for improvements. I've recently wrote you about this. Could you shortly give us an insight? Like, if I want to hire and pay someone for some improvements, what are the options?
I mentioned Paul, and I know that he is interested in implementing things and getting paid for it. There are other developers. There's no formal system at the moment. There might be one in the future. It is currently being planned, discussed, actually started to have a company in Berlin that does all this. For the moment, it is still necessary to personally contact the developer, tell him what you want, and hopefully he will answer you what he can offer. Sorry.
Any questions? I see you. Yes. All right.
Some provocative question.
Please.
Did somebody in the world know the direction of development of FFmpeg?
Again, sorry, I didn't get it.
Did somebody in the world know the direction of development of FFmpeg?
The question is if the direction of development is known. Well, my provocative answer would be forward, because as I tried to explain is we normally do not remove features. We did now once for a very specific reason that I believe does not... It cannot happen very often because we normally do not, we will not accept wrappers for proprietary external libraries anymore, so there won't be a reason to remove it. No, new features are added. Yeah? If new formats are invented, they are hopefully added to FFmpeg. They are not added by some kind of master plan. Yeah? But on the contrary, they are mostly added because a developer is curious about how does this new format work. He tries to re-implement it. The initial try may not be successful, but it is a kind of roadmap for others then. And after sometimes in the last 20 years, all formats were added, except if they were so remote that nobody used them, because typically we are less interested in formats that nobody uses and more interested in formats that actually get some usage in the real world. So while we don't have an AV1 decoder as of now, you can decode AV1 because we have two external libraries taking care, I would expect that at some point in the future there will be a native AV1 decoder. But that may not be soon, and there are definitely no plans on when to release the next version, that's for sure.
Actually, I think we're going to go to the next speaker, if you don't mind. Okay. Thanks, Carl.
Thank you.